protection, welfare.
Structure.
Structure.
Just ignore the mic. The mic's pretty hot too. So, yeah, just ignore it. Meaning you don't need to, it's picking me up right now.
Okay. Hello. Hi. Okay. And let him put his hand.
I have to wear a microphone. I think so. Do you hear it? I kind of hear it. Okay, how about now? Okay. It's too much. Okay, I have three things. How many do you have? Can you hear me? Is this okay?
Oh.
I'm not talking that loud. Should I talk louder?
Yeah. So there are two.
Yeah.
One, two,
it'll
three,
be
one,
okay.
So the default one is one. Mine is two. This Mac is one.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
So just press.
It's too much.
One.
Yeah.
That one.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello? Hi. Hello? Hello.
I have some reserve.
agency.
Structure.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So I think Helen told me to just get started by myself. So my name is TC. This presentation is dedicated to our shared interest in media arts. Okay, so now imagine you are in a cinema alone, dark. So you are kind of disconnected from people around you now. So the first piece of artwork I want to show you is called Serenity Disturbed. Serenity Disturbed is a piece of interactive art. So it responds to sound in the environment. So oftentimes we get disturbed by noise or comments. But noise is just one of numerous annoying things in life. So so after the trouble is gone, we return peace gradually. So this piece is about a never-ending journey of losing and regaining inner peace. And the second piece I want to show you is called Dating Pool.
Hooray.
So Dating Pool was created 3 years ago. I think it's
leave me in a relationship.
So I think it's a response to the question I had, how can I find a perfect partner for myself at the time? So each dot represents a person, and each person has a personality score from 0 to 100. So the idea is if two dots share a similar score, they will form a couple. But if their scores are very different, they will stay separated. So I took a lot of classes about mathematical modeling when I was an undergraduate student. So I just apply that into art. So, and the other thing is I'm interested in abstraction. In terms of visual style, it's following the suprematism art movement and the style art movement. So it's about pure color art forms. And the next piece I want to show you is called Free Again. It's a game. This game is quite important to me because it's the merging of my two major efforts. One is LGBTQ studies, the other one is coding. So I just use games as a medium to express my thinking of LGBTQ studies. So this was made in 2017. So here's the game. So it's like the snake game. But it's a variation of the snake game. So you need to get certain amount of each piece in order to reach the next level. And there are 5 levels. And the levels are about have different themes. For example, level 1, mainly men. 2, 3, 4, 5 are childhood, teenager, young adult, and future. So it's about the spectrum model of human sexuality. This model is more lenient than the binary model of gender expectations. So so Free Again, it's free from rigid conception of gender expectations using a more lenient conceptual model. And so I've been making queer games for many years, from 2017 to 2021, almost one piece per year. I was doing something else in 2019. So I will show you 2 more pieces, and then I will talk about the differences over the years. So this was the 2020 piece. It's about finding other unicorns and clean stigma about homosexuality spread out in a subway carriage cart. And so after you find another unicorn, your field of vision will increase. Okay, another one. Yeah. Okay,
And then the other thing you need to is you have to move other people to help you encircle the stigma, and the stigma will disappear. For example, we push this person and then the I disappear. I is a part of the word immoral. So homosexuality as a word is in proximity to other words like immoral. According to a machine learning algorithm like word to vect, it calculates the distance between words. So this is another piece, that's 2020, and 2021, so becomes this piece.
Agency.
So you are the driver of the
structure.
Spaceship.
Structure.
Welfare. Protection.
Structure.
Okay, so this this piece is about liberation, liberty. So according to my understanding, liberty is made of expression, protection, and welfare. And there are different levels of liberty, so there are 6 levels for you to complete. So, and then there is a pair of sociological concepts, agency and structure. So structure is custom, religion, gender, ability, which limits your choice in life, and agency is your choice. So, for example, there is a choice between hiding yourself or being authentic, but if you want to make the choice, you have to somehow escape the structure, social structure, or somehow find a way to fight for the liberation. So this game is very, actually, I was playing lots of sports when I was making this game, so the mechanism is very athletic, and then the color is very bright, because I observed that like athletes like to wear very, very bright colors, especially soccer players. And then, so the general trend is from 2017 to 2021, the journal is from a more personal to a sociological. It's probably because I'm reading more LGBTQ study stuff, and then also maybe my personal life has changed a bit. But in the future, I'm going to will move from theoretical to historical. And then the other interesting is the classic battle between narratology and ludology. This is game study stuff. So at the beginning, free again is like, it has narrative and it has game mechanism, but they are quite separated. In Safe Zone 2018, the game mechanism and narrative are quite integrated. And in 2020 and 2021, I did not include narrative. It's I convey the message slowly through game mechanism. In the future, I will add the narrative, but in a probably different way. Okay. This piece is very hard to explain because it's very complicated, but I recently found a way to explain it. So basically, I will identify the components of this model for you. So this piece is basically a sculpture, and then it's about 10-inch height. It's 3D printed, and it's a tree. It's made in Blender. It's procedurally generated using Python API. And these are flowers on the tree are generated using machine intelligence, and there are 2 matrices stuck in the tree for some purposeful reasons. And then these are wind turbines. They can actually spin, so it's a wind sculpture, a connected sculpture. So that's how I just identified the elements of the sculpture instead of talking about the philosophy behind it. But I do understand the philosophy behind it. So basically, it's about glitch art. So it's about glitch art's philosophy of creating newness through amplifying instead of removing difference. This is basically there is an article called Glitch Failure, Constructing a Queer Politics of Listening. I got lots of ideas from there. And then the other is the existence of multiple time at the same time. So that means we have different ages, but we were born at different time, but we are in the same room in the same time now. And this idea is also echoed in this artwork. So this was made in 2019, but it took me 2 years to fully realize what I was doing. So it took a lot of post completion research to actually write artistic abstract about all the precise thinking, how I can elaborate the ideas in our work precisely. So, and what I'm going to, so this is about the, it's kind of like a mind map of my practice. It's also what I want to do in the future. So there are three key elements of my practice. So it's plants, attraction, game, and generative. So at UCLA, I'm interested in expanding on NFT, game studies. So to game study can help me to articulate my game design, and also point me to new territories of games. And also interested in collaborate with the LGBTQ studies at UCLA. Also interesting taking some class in parametric design, and also study media arts, contemporary arts topics to learn about the context. So in summary, so live long, keep learning, make queer indie games every year, make generative plans that whisper whatever is on my mind, mainly about being questioning queer Chinese diaspora, and last but not least, be happy. Thank you. Any questions? Yeah. How did I get into it? So basically find a thing that you can jump into right away. For example, here there is so ML5, and then there is they have a example using VirtualVect, and then it will show you, for example, rainbow is nearest to the some words. And then just from that example, you can directly use the result in your artwork without actually applying the technology. So that's the easy way to integrate VirtualVect into your artwork.
Can you explain the basic idea?
Yeah, the basic idea of VirtualVect is calculate distance between words, the similarity between words using their context. For example, I am happy, I am sad, always have the similar context. It's I am, just like replace happy with sad. So they have different, they have similar, they always apply, appear in a similar grammatical structure, so they are similar. Happy and sad are actually very similar words according to VirtualVect. It's this kind of calculation. Any question?
Do you feel like when you're making a game, so many of the games that you make are so based on theory and reading that you've done? Do you feel like you're more, when you're making a game, you're more thinking about the theoretical framework, or are there other games that do you feel more inspired by what you read, or inspired by what you play?
Right. So I hope my game's mechanisms are original. So, but they are obviously reminiscent of classical game mechanisms. If I can avoid, I will avoid to get inspiration from other games. And it's mainly about my life experience. That gives me the urgency to create a piece. And then it's also about wrapping my language using these theoretical frameworks. So I think I took inspirations from all sources, but some I need to, I have to avoid, even it probably inspires me somehow, but I have to be original. And but some I can directly quote them, then I can actually, for example, theory is easy to quote, you just quote them, so they are safer. Question?
Thank you.
I don't like my own game yet. So there is a place that maybe one day I will like my own game. So I do not like my own games yet. Maybe one day after transformations, I will like my own game. So I don't know how to reach there. Does that answer the question somehow? Okay. So question, or am I? Okay, stop, okay, thanks.
This is exactly what they told us not to do, and we're doing it, changing from computer to computer. Okay. Can you see that? Yes. Okay, so hi, everyone. My name is Bomi. I'm a Korean-Canadian from Calgary, Alberta. I come from a fine arts background in media arts, and my art practice mainly consists of world building and storytelling in multimedia narratives, so with 3D animation, games, and performances with electronics and interactive installations. My research interests are focused on the social, political, and ontological effects of global computation, particularly within the spheres of urbanism, network geopolitics, interfacial worlding, and user psychogeography, and I'm going to explain all of that, so don't worry. So a lot of my work interpret political power as a practice of world making, so techniques and forms that generate ways of seeing and being in the world. And I guess what I'm interested is in how technology exercises this power as it situates and orients people in real time and space and effectively remake our reality according to more machine-derived imaginaries and logic. And in recent projects, I've been working on fictional narratives that imagine the dramas of techno-governance and techno-utopias over multiple urban realities and user populations spread out across the globe. And in these pieces, the planet itself is reconceived as a megastructure of information and matter. Through the computational systems that quantify matter and render the world itself as information. And in these pieces, viewers are sort of taken on this journey inside this planetary architecture for a visual and spatial experience of both physical and virtual spaces that are absorbed or generated by computation. The resulting entanglement that happens to bodies across space and time, and how that allows for new ways of nonlinear being for entities to exist on multispatial, multitemporal, and multi-scaled paradigms. My aim with all of this is really to creatively model these strange abstract information networks and infrastructures that we're now all a part of into immersive environments and actually embodied structures that viewers can actually spatially enter and visually access and narratively experience to better understand the ways we exist and live within the conditions of our information culture. And reconceiving the planet this way through global computation sort of allows me to rethink about political geographies as well, moving more away from the traditional borders or like international borders and physical institutions and physical nation states toward more invisible political agents and the governing domains of software sovereignties So I'm really interested in speculating these globally disseminated platforms as sovereign states, as and sort of thinking about their transcontinental spheres of influence as a political territory, as a sovereign, autonomous territory that governs this globally distributed and this contiguous body of user citizens. And how they do that. So I'm really interested also in addressing systems and grids and other indexical matrix systems of different platforms. And I'm particularly doing this to interrogate that activity of world mapping as a world-making process and therefore a politically situated action. A lot of my narratives like to imagine the city as governed and claimed and reconstructed by a multitude of these software sovereignties that bubble over the surface of the city and expose within the city the territorial domains and jurisdictional envelopes of different platforms that are, you know, constantly shifting and adapting and at war with each other over the urban landscape. So this really, you know, in this process, I'm thinking about how these software is programming the urban space with the flow of people, information, and things, and how it's mediating that hyperconnectivity between really far-flung things across distant geographies, and how that actually sort of allows us to see the city beyond its physical construct as through universalized urbanism, to see our city as a part of this multispatial continuum onto a larger global stage. In doing so, I'm sort of imagining the city more as sort of like a kaleidoscopic hybrid reality that is a jungle of both computation and concrete, subdivided, fragmented, and weaved between physical and virtual. And universalized urbanism is only made possible through interfaces that are scattered across the urban surface. And I'm interested in how these interfaces are actually collecting, generating, categorizing, and curating information about the world to describe our world in very particular ways. You know, creating these utopic visions of the world that is unique to the interface. Circumscribing how things are, how things should be, what can be made, what can be deleted, who should be seen or hidden. And sort of in all of this, I'm questioning how these world images of interfaces contain social, political motives and ideals, and how these images are actually sort of operating as utopias themselves that are being realized into reality as we respond and think and move and act according to their projections, as we believe and accept the world to be the way that that the interface is represented to us. And in this, I'm also sort of exploring screens themselves as architects of a user psychogeography. So I'm really interested in how screens actually situate the user as an embodied subject within the world that they create, and how this affects our experience of physical place and the quality of the urban space as, you know, when our gaze and our subjectivity becomes structured and multiplied by all of these alternative spatial projections from interfaces all around us, and how through this process, our subjectivity actually becomes fragmented and reconstructed by these interfaces. So Cafe Machina is my most recent project. It's an interactive choreographic performance with two industrial motors. I'm just gonna turn them on. The piece is questioning how technology is directing our reality, our relationships, and our experience of the world. Viewers are peeking into this really weird, strange room where these machines are navigating humans through the darkness. And the two performers are blindfolded, masked, and bound to the two motors. The machines pull them inward or release them outward to circumscribe their mobility and placement across the space. And throughout the performance, the people are grasping into the darkness, hoping to grab hold of anything in what feels like this abyss of existential uncertainty. In doing so, they're stumbling into objects and walls and occasionally each other. And so when the machines are loosening their grip, they enable a wider span of movement for the performers and a greater possibility of an encounter. But when the machines tighten their grip, they actually tear the performers away from each other to be lost from each other once again into the dark. So it's really looking at relationships becoming this highly mediated event through the technology that both connects and separates people, and, you know, questioning how through these systems things just appear out of the dark into the visible to be presenced and felt and to be held and to be known. Really curious about how technology is dictating who or what gets to be seen and associated in what order and conditions. I guess my general aim overall with the piece was to reveal realities that we have come to know, and the sociality that we come to take part in and to perform really may not be ours at all. Might be of, as I mentioned in earlier, machine-derived imaginaries and logic. So I think overall my practice, I'm just looking at how machines structure the becoming of our world and our becoming in that world. And I think time's up. Okay. Questions? Hi.
So, Romy, in this your final piece, this Cafe Machina, so mm-hmm. Can you just talk a little bit about how these motors have been programmed?
So
what decides, I mean, how much, leeway, how much possibilities they give for this program?
Yes. They are coded to at random. But within a specific range, because those motors can actually take up to 3,000 or 4,000 pounds, so they can actually rip your arm off. So if I had left it, go on for too long, and we're blindfolded, right? So it's like in this room, we're blindfolded, so much noise with the machines, and all of a sudden your arm's gone. I actually can't believe my last school let me do this at the school, because it was actually a really dangerous project. But yeah, it's randomized, but it's within a very specific range that it's safe for the performers. Hi. Yeah, so between fiction and nonfiction, I'm really interested in how much of fiction is actually real. How much of, we think of sci-fi and we think, snow crash and all of this, and I'm wondering how much of that is actually has come true and has that we are living, and how we can use those narratives in a way to critique our current conditions and to sort of deconstruct and understand the ways that we are. And I think a lot of it also, I do use the term world building as a way of expressing my method of speculating in it, because a lot of the information, like how Google stores, address systems, we don't know, right? So a lot of it is a lot of the narratives, I have to speculate how they're storing, what's happening, who has power, how that power is distributed. So I think my method in general with these narratives is speculation, and perhaps that's why I've been saying world building, but yeah. Any other question?
Hi. I'm really interested in your concentration on cities.
Yes.
And I'm wondering, are you drawing from certain kind of people or artists, and then are you thinking back on the history of the city state?
Mm.
Because that seems to be something that I think is worth considering right now, and then there's a quality of kind of cultural analytics maybe going to do.
Yes. I think that is a lot of research that I want to get started here. I think for me, I'm fascinated with cities because it's the place where all of this comes together, where matter and information and governance and visible and invisible, oh God, Helen just said stop, come together. So that's sort of why I like to put cities as like the setting of these narratives, to really like dive into, okay, this bubble of weird software envelope, now I'm moving through it. Oh, gated access, can't go through it. I have to stop. But yes, that's probably why. And I would love more information about resources about cities and cyberpunk in general and all of that. So thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. My name is Camille. My pronouns are she and they. I am a research-based artist working in the intersection of biopolitics, language, and technology. My background is that I had studied art and environmental studies at UC Santa Barbara, and the foundation for my work stems from the relationship between land, animals, and humans because of the importance in the construction of race, gender, and power. So to start off, this is a quote from Rebecca Solnit. The desire to understand the universe is not the same as the desire to control it. But the definition of progress came to mean not understanding, but control, and not spiritual or social improvement, but the advancement of power, which meant geographical manifest destiny in the America of Thoreau's age and means technological manifest destiny in our own. So I really like this quote because I think it talks about a lot of the themes in my practice, which include control, dominance, power, and also like the tools and the way in which we wield this power, such as geography and technology. So the first piece that I'm gonna show you guys is called Land, Animals, and Humans. I was working with the themes of power, domination, and I was interested in the human domination to control and the distinction between man and animal, and also man and human. So in David Nybert's book, Animal Violence and Human Oppression, he argues that the domestication of large sociable beings has directly undermined the development of a just and sustainable society. So the idea that the domestication of animal labor used in agriculture, labor, and war has led to the systemic oppression of human bodies. So in this piece, I had collected soil from the Angeles Crest, casted them into cow hooves, and then placed them back on the land to comment on animal-human labor, material histories, and also site specificity. So I subsequently became interested in biopower and biopolitics and the organization of biological life on a hierarchical scale. So this diagram was created by a language theorist named John Cherry, who argues that in our language and with Western cultural perception, certain nouns are imbued with more animacy or more aliveness than others. So the idea is that the further down you go on this scale, the less animate or alive you are, and therefore the more apt you are to die. Sorry. Thinking about this scale, I was interested in how activating language and insults could be used as a tool or weapon to reinforce these social hierarchies of power. How through banal social interactions, you could simultaneously perform a species demotion while also reinforcing this entangled power dynamic. So in this piece, Facebook posts from current and former police officers refer to humans as animals, which in turn reinforce this perception of power and also reinforce this like entangled relationship.
These animals need to be tortured and mutilated in a public square.
The reporter is, as usual, a racist pig. The women are, as usual, filthy animal bitches. The officer is, as usual, totally correct. Max Kramer is, as usual, a great guy and a good attorney. He's doing his job. He won't be successful, but he's doing his job.
These animals need.
So, following this thought process, I began to explore animism, or the attribution of emotions, sentience, and liveliness in inanimate objects. So in this piece, I was exploring animism in colors. The data from this is sourced from the NRC Word Color Association Lexicon, which is this crowdsourced project where this researcher had basically gathered a bunch of words from the dictionary and asked participants to assign a color with each word. So I was interested in how patterns and unconscious biases begin to emerge as you continue watching on, and which words are associated with what color and what affect is associated with which word. Okay, so now we move on to the digital. So during COVID, I was completely removed from my physical studio space, and so my practice shifted entirely online. I was already interested in data and like implicit bias, so I began asking questions and thinking critically about the internet as this democratic landscape. Those with the power to design systems also have the power to privilege certain information over others. So this is a piece called Here's What I Found On, and it's an interactive website that explores the search engine as this ongoing cultural artifact in this archive. So using 38,000 Google searches from my personal browsing history since 2014, this piece revisits a collection of like forgotten intentions, interests, and curiosities. The way that this website works is that you click on the screen and then it returns a randomized search query until fragments of the coder's identity is revealed. Underscoring this piece is the idea that behind every code is a person with a set of personal beliefs that no code can completely eradicate. Okay, so that was sort of my first foray into coding and programming, and I became interested in how code was similar to poetry in the way that it broke the constraint of every semantic rule in language that I was familiar with. So this is a piece that I did in collaboration with a friend and poet, and his poem is titled Of the World. And in this poem, the word cell is analyzed. So the word cell can refer to the prison industrial system, it can refer to a physiological building block, and it can also refer to a biological unit of length. This website is constructed in a way where each cell contains a word, and then when you click on the cell, it divides in half and the following word in the poem is revealed. So, in March of this year, I did a residency back in my hometown, which is Oakland, California, and I had heard that the Oakland A's were planning on building a new waterfront stadium using funding from taxpayers. Developers and supporters often tout stadiums as a way to like increase the revenue of a city. More visibility, more jobs, more tourism. However, research shows that stadiums irrevocably change the genetic makeup of a city. It changes the housing composition, the income demographic, and like the racial composition. So this piece is titled Corporate Stadium, and it uses a data set of 112 publicly funded stadiums in the country from major sport franchises. I took these images and I fed it through a GAN, and these generative images emphasize the convergence of techno-colonialism, market forces, and public infrastructure. So, during my time at DMA, I'm interested in developing a research project that would touch on themes of public infrastructure, spatialized racial class design, and digital mapping. And this is largely motivated by my background growing up in Oakland, which is, you know, a multicultural, diverse city, but it's also a city deeply impacted by like redlining practices and segregation. So I'm sort of interested in the access to opportunity and returning to themes of land, geography, control, power, and like design systems. And that's it. Question?
Hi. So I'm really interested. Earlier in your talk, you mentioned an interest in inanimate objects. And I was wondering if there's any relation between coding and poetry piece in particular, and bringing inanimate objects to life, or having kind of an animating effect on the computer.
Yeah. I think, particularly with that piece, I was sort of interested in the subversion of like a useful GUI. So it's like, how can the artist and the viewer participate in a collaborative piece? And so a lot of these like net art pieces that I'm doing rely on the participant interacting with the piece in order for you to really understand what it is. So I think in a way, you know, that might touch on sort of like what like animating the piece and making it feel alive. I'm actually in a digital humanities course right now.
Oh.
Yeah, it's the digital mapping course.
Okay. That was
yeah, it's really good.
Sorry,
it's a good point.
Can you talk about
techno-orientalism? Yeah, so techno-orientalism is something that I've been thinking about within the last year, and it's sort of this like phenomenon in like sci-fi culture where like Asians are sort of depicted as like really tech savvy and like really advanced, but also like needing the like Western imperialism because of like their animalistic tendencies. So I'm sort of interested in how like cyberpunk media and these like films sort of depict Asians in this way. But I mean, I'm still pretty fresh with it, so I can't like describe it more in detail, but I'm sort of interested again in those like power structures of like race, like hierarchy and techno-colonialism. No more questions? Thank you.
I'm next. It's kind of nice having a mask on because nobody can tell if I have sandwich in my teeth. No. So hi everybody, my name is Wiley Wiggins. I am making digital games and spaces of play. This is my website. There's a bunch of stuff on here. Pretty much everything I do is on here, but a lot of it isn't surface. You can search through. I'm just going to click on a recent thing and take a look at it real quick, and then I'll backtrack and give some context. Good internet in here. Some of you have probably already seen this before. This was actually a project when I was a undergrad at DMA. This is called Obelisk. Obelisk is comprised of a collection of 3D objects, a computer game, and a book. Obelisk is a work about debt, extraction, and the relationship between our aspirations for the future, our memories of the past, and the materiality of the present. For more information, visit obelisk.quest. So that was a game, a sort of playable amateur game that I situated in a bunch of different ways. One of them was a giant book of an instruction booklet that was procedurally generated and is pretty confusing. Let me backtrack a little bit. So if you Google me, you're probably going to find a bunch of stuff about movies that I was in, which is a sort of a weird side note. A couple of these are relevant because I either worked also, in addition to being a performer, as an animator or a motion graphics artist. This one from 2000, Waking Life, kind of set me on the path that I've been on for the last 20 years or so. I moved from doing motion graphics work to doing live visuals for bands. I did a lot of work for a band in Austin called The Octopus Project, which was great because it sort of moved me from doing pre-rendered stuff to doing a lot more programmatic stuff, playing with spaces, playing with interactions with audiences. I started doing interactive stuff, projection mapping stuff. But my first love and first interest is digital games. Even though as a kid growing up, I didn't always really have direct access to them. This is actually the first computer that I ever owned. This is the Timex Sinclair 1000, which was a pocket calculator-like thing that my mother dug out of the trash at her work. I spent hours and hours going through this book that came with it, transcribing a Monopoly game and making these sort of chatbots that cussed in BASIC. I spent about 8-9 years as the producer of an event in Austin, Texas called Fantastic Arcade. This is an indie and art video game festival. We had a lot of selections that were submitted, but we also commissioned a lot of games from artists. And a lot of what I did in my time there was create spaces for them, create, in a lot of cases, arcade cabinets for them or events around them. And it's worth bringing up because I got really focused there on games as part of a sort of situated social action. So I was interested not so much in just the software, definitely not the software as a discrete, ephemeral piece of culture, but not just the interplay between the person playing a game and the software, but also spectators, setting, interface, really almost games as installation art. And that's kind of what I want to do here. So this is a piece that I did where I had taken the sort of skills that I learned doing live visuals and did a installation performance with them. This is called Shapes and Other Shapes. It was part of a series called Alter in Austin, Texas. I did this with the Octopus Project and Everest Pipkin. It hinged on a random text generator that Everest wrote that had a corpus of creation and destruction myths. And then the musical performance and my visual performance were decided by the sort of random turns of this text generator. Obelisk, I've spoken about. Obelisk is sort of a comment on extraction as a mechanic in games. So games like Minecraft, you have unlimited strip mining of a world with no real kind of repercussions. Obelisk, the idea is it's situated as this game from like 1989 that has been extracted down to bedrock, and there's really not much left of it. One of the things that I did was I had my friends all leave comments on the download page where they were expressing their anger that the game that they remembered playing as children was not what they were playing now, and there wasn't really anything left of it. I'm doing a lot of work with random text and interactive fiction. These are a couple of projects that were done in Python using a framework called Django. This first one is called Grotto, and it treats web pages as rooms and users as characters. And then it sort of becomes a substrate for including other artworks. The one on the right is called Sea of Objects, and it's a multi-user dungeon about the production and reification of objects. It uses random object generators. This is kind of what Grotto looks like when it's got other art running in it. So some of the themes that I'm working with, as I said, I'm creating spaces of play. I'm very interested in something that my friend Rachel Weil calls critical retrocomputing. So this is sort of like a reappraisal of the past of digital games and consumer electronics, alternate histories, and that's something that I could spend a lot more time talking about. And what I want to do here, I do a lot of different disparate things. I'm a 2D animator, I've done some performance, I do a lot of creative writing, I'm a middling programmer, and I want to synthesize all those things together as best I can. And I'm also interested in a sort of an ethnography of games and of human-computer interaction. I've read a lot of Lucy Suchman. I've seen a lot of really great stuff about rediscovery of these sort of abandoned virtual worlds. That's something that interests me. And the project that I have planned for my solo show is, I think, going to be a projection-mapped simulation. Any questions? Yeah. So I've done a lot of stuff with, I worked a lot with an artist friend named Rachel Simone Weil. Rachel is a assembly programmer who primarily focuses on NES programming, the original Nintendo, but she's also runs a museum called Femicom, which is a sort of like incredibly comprehensive museum, online museum of girl and femme games. She's a really great touch point on this. We did a bunch of work from an alternate past where HyperCard, the multimedia program that Apple created in the, that Bill Atkinson on the Apple created in the late 80s, early 90s, became the first web browser. So we created this whole little world from that. This is a HyperCard stack that we made that we actually inserted into the Internet Archive, and they think it's an actual old HyperCard stack, but it comes from a world where there's a peer-to-peer decentralized HyperCard internet. I did some video projections with that world. So she did a really great talk at MAGFest where she told all of these retro game nerds that unexamined nostalgia was toxic, which was a joyful thing to see. She had this great quote from Svetlana Boym in her talk, where she says that nostalgia is the promise to rebuild the ideal home that lies at the core of many powerful ideologies of today, tempting us to relinquish critical thinking for emotional bonding. The danger of nostalgia is that it tends to confuse the actual home with an imaginary one, and in extreme cases, it can create a phantom homeland for the sake of which one is ready to die or kill. And I think this resonates with me a ton with current games and also with like nostalgia for childhood games. A lot of times these sort of spaces of fantasy, these fantasy worlds, these magic circles, we've moved into them as if they're real places that we're ready to defend to the death. And the way that I kind of have chosen to engage with some of that stuff in the work that I'm working on now is to try and reconnect with my own nostalgia and idea of games and sort of extrapolate that to other things. Thanks, everybody.
Hi, my name is Ariel. I'm a media artist and teacher. I'm from the south of Argentina, from a little city called Bariloche, which is very beautiful. I've been teaching for the last 5 or 6 years since I finished university. I've taught in a number of places. I have a very strong interest in education, specifically in public education. So whenever I've had the privilege to choose where I work, I choose to work in public institutions. And by public, I mean free, so just free access. I'd like to share some material from teaching. So teaching art in Argentina, specifically in my city, means fighting against lack of funding and just lack of political interest in culture. So it also means learning to improvise and do things anyway. So this is from a printmaking class that I taught where we wanted to make prints larger than our press could fit. So we did something else. I also teach children, and I've been very lucky. I've been able to teach class with two other teachers, one of them a printmaking teacher and one of them a writing teacher. And we've made projects, like editorial projects. We've published books with our kids. This is from a particular student who specifically asked me to not forget about him and his classmates when I left my city a month ago. And I'm going to do my best to translate this. It says, "I went to a field with all the flowers in the world. As I ran and I ran, I felt different aromas, not one, but millions. I couldn't believe it, and little by little, I turned into a tree and I was pleased." And I think this is beautiful and I'm extremely proud. And I think that it's important because I really would have loved to have this kind of exposure to art at this age. This is done by a 9-year-old. So I think it's really important for me to occupy these spaces of teaching. I also teach video game classes for kids. This is done by 10-year-olds. I teach them how to animate and code and design games. But I think the most important thing that I try to get them to believe is that they can make their own stuff and that they don't need to accept whatever the market imposes on them. Maybe they can make games that are relevant to their contexts and their desires and their experiences, besides like playing a foreign soldier shooting people somewhere else or something like that. I've also taught creative coding classes. This is from like different projects that students have made that have had no previous experience coding. And this has also been really rewarding. I mentioned this because teaching is, I think it's very central to my practice. I enjoy it a lot and I learn a lot from it. I learn a lot about myself and about my community. And I think it's something that I will continue to pursue. And it's something that I've came here for. I'd like to learn from other teachers, and I'd also like to learn through the act of teaching. So this is one of the reasons I'm here. I also worry a lot about access to art and culture. And In my city, it's very difficult to show work. There are very few exhibition spaces, and they're more designed to show like paintings or more traditional stuff. It's very difficult to show stuff that's, for instance, screen-based. So at the beginning of this year, the city council made a shady arrangement with an advertising company to put some LED screens in the city, and they were the first that we ever had, and I was so angry. I was just furious. And with my partner, who has a cooler head than I do, we came up with this plan to make an art show, like a video art show in the public space. And we somehow convinced the owner of the screens to give us some time, some screen time. So we made an open call, and we got a lot of proposals from the region. And we had a really good team of colleagues that selected 10 of these works. And does this work? Okay. And we ran a show for like a month, and it was great. I think this is important to me as an experience. I learned a lot from it, but it also sets a precedent, at least in my community, that these type of horrible invasive technologies can be used for other purposes. So I thought this was really important. It was also really intense because we finished it the weekend before we left. Another thing that I worry about is, how can I make things that have a more direct impact on people's lives, even if it's small? Like, how can I make things that are more public and easily accessible? This is a project that I made with a friend. It's a metal box, and it has a button, and you press it, and it tells you a story or a poem, and we put it in a bus stop, like in a public bus stop that's like far away from everything and where you can wait for a long time for the bus to come. And it's really small and it's really simple, like it's just a button and it plays sound, but we got really good feedback from it. This is just a short clip. That's a fraction of a poem by Cuban revolutionary poet Nicolás Guillén. And this was like a really simple and easy thing to do. Like, we didn't even ask for permission. We stole the electricity from a restaurant. And it was really good. It had like a really deep impact. People were like really grateful about this. This is an installation I did some years ago. I'm running a little short on time, so I'll try to hurry. This is a wall of empty postcards. They seem empty. But in the installation view, the whole room is dark, and there's this projected like noise, digital noise over it. And as time goes by, images begin to appear on the postcards. The postcards are painted with phosphorescent pigment. And I can play that again. These images are of people that have been killed at the hand of the Argentinian state during my lifetime. They're like my dead people that I remember. And this piece is about memory, and it's about conserving that memory. And this is a better view of the faces. So people could take the postcards home, and each postcard has a face of somebody. And because it's just the remains of light on a phosphorescent plate, it's very fragile. So in order to like keep it, you have to like really take care of it, and you have to keep it like close to your body or cover it. And so I think I made this as an exercise in collective memory, and how can we remember all these people and take like share responsibility for it. This is a piece that I made in 2019. It's about I have a missing grandmother due to horrible political practices in Argentina during the 70s and 60s. And this is a piece about finding her. It's a little piece of hardware. It's a wearable device that scans faces and puts people's faces in this empty space between me and my mom. And it tries to calculate how much this person looks like my grandmother, and like how like close the possibility is that that person might be my grandmother. And it communicates with me through like a little heartbeat. It vibrates, and it gets excited if somebody looks like my grandmother. And this doesn't, of course, it doesn't really work, but it stems from this idea of, I became really interested in this idea of creating machines or systems to alleviate emotional labor? Like, can I offload emotional labor and pain onto a machine or a system? Will that help in some way? And I made this while I was in New York in the School for Poetic Computation, and this was really painful to make. And I think I was able to make it because I was in a place where I felt that there was a community that contained and cared for me and also helped me technically a lot. So this is another reason that I'm here. I'm interested in creating or being part of a community that generates care and a safe space to take risks such as this. This is a diagram that I made of like the power dynamics in my family and society that led to the piece that I just showed. I'll skip this last one because I don't have time. But I've made a list of interests and concerns. I'm interested in education, in access to art and culture, in the history of labor and labor movements. I'm interested in this idea of emotional labor, in social justice, in death, memory, and community. And I'm very concerned with injustice, exclusivity, militarism, policing, surveillance, and colonialism. And I'm out of time, but I want to mention, I realize that this puts me in a space of contradiction, being here in the United States, which is a country that is very violent towards other countries, and specifically it's the country that generated the military dictatorships in South America, specifically the last wave of them during the 70s, and has brought great pain and suffering to my family and my friends and myself. So I'm interested in exploring this contradiction. I feel like I'm in a space of tension, and I'm interested in seeing what that tension makes. So thank you. I don't know if there are any questions. Yeah. Sure, thank you. This is a project that I'm working on. This isn't finished. It's about this idea of machines that do work for me. This is, I've had a stressful year, and like I clenched my jaw and it hurts, and I feel like I'm chewing on pieces of glass all the time. So I'm making this machine that breaks its jaw for me. It's very literal, but I like it. These are just some tests of getting this prototype to move in the same way that I do. And these are some like destruction tests, like some stress tests, working with materials that will break over time that appear to be very rigid, but that auto-destroy themselves. So yeah. Anything else? Okay, thank you. Yeah. Yeah, I don't think I have a quick answer for that. I'd have to think a little bit about it. Okay, thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Maya, and I wanted to Oh, microphone. I wanted to share my work today in a way that felt, in an environment that felt very comfortable to me. So I made a website, but I realized after I made it, I made like a doom scroll website. So maybe that also means something. So right here at the top is my personal website. This is how you would probably meet me if we did not have the extreme privilege of being here together right now. And this will tell you all of the basic facts. I have a degree in computer science and media studies from Pomona College, which is in Claremont, California, not far from here. But I actually want to start the story today from a very different place. And that is Irving Goffman's 1956 book, The Presentation of Self in Everyday Life. Irving Goffman is a sociologist, and in this book, he proposes a dramaturgical theory of socializing, basically saying that every social interaction that we have is a performance. And he has this quote, "The world is, in truth, a wedding." And reading this really resonated with me. And when I think about it, it's probably because I grew up doing competitive dance in middle and high school. And I'm still a dancer. I do a lot of that. We'll get to that. But this was like the energy of what it was to be on stage. It's like exaggerated performance, like hyper feminine. So that's where I was coming from when I was growing up in a small town in Pennsylvania. And kind of around the same time when I started dancing, I was also getting really into using iMovie and making like music video parodies on my parents' Mac. And this is a work from 2010. I'll just share a brief clip.
Kim pedicure on our toes, trying on all our clothes, boys blowing up our phones.
So yeah, so that's kind of what I was about when I was younger. And it's funny because now I can trace like a very direct link between what I'm doing now and where I was coming from. But after that phase of life, I went on and I've always loved math, I've always loved logic, and when I discovered coding, it was huge for me because I loved that I could create things that were logic and code-based, and so I decided to study computer science. And in my second year of college, I actually discovered processing and P5, and that just totally warped my world. I never thought of myself as an artist before, and I realized that I wanted to be part of this community. So naturally, a lot of the work that I started creating involved the process of putting myself on screen. I knew being on stage and the computer screen to me became this kind of stage that I was able to manipulate my own image on. So this is a piece I made in 2018 called Paint Me in Pixels So I Can Dance Forever. I'm gonna go through these quickly because of time, but they all are meaningful to me. I came from New York where I worked at the Google Creative Lab, and one of the projects I worked on there was in collaboration with Bill T. Jones, who's an American dancer and choreographer. And this is a program I wrote that uses the web speech-to-text API to transcribe what the dancer says, and then it uses PoseNet, which is a machine learning model, and Native Canvas to transcribe that and allow the dancer to move that around screen. This is a music video that I actually was on the dancing choreography side rather than the technology side. It's directed by my friend Saad Musaji. But I performed the movement for over 200 characters in this video. And it was very strange to see like my movement that I'd choreographed and performed on like a muscly white man or like all these different characters in the end. And this was for the artist Joji for his song 777. And then the most recent work here that I've done it that involves dance was part of the show Social Codes, which was on Ferrofile earlier in 2021. And I'll actually show you here. Move my mouse. So I'm moving the mouse, and the form of myself dancing is moving over top of that. And I created this during COVID when we were quarantining, and I was feeling isolated, and I really wanted to make something that was interactive, that felt like the viewer. The person who was visiting the piece was co-creating it with me. And so it's called Can I Go Where You Go? Which actually is a line in a Taylor Swift song, but I've never told anyone that. So while I've been doing all of this dance work, I studied media studies, and I've been always really obsessed, and I don't use that word lightly, with thinking about how I appear on screen. And I in 2018 was thinking a lot about, you know that feeling when someone's staring at you and like you're not looking back at them and it's kind of awkward and you're like, why are they looking at me? I realized that was how my computer felt because I was staring at it like for 9 hours a day and it didn't get a chance to look back at me. And I was like, wow, we need to have a moment where we like acknowledge each other. So I created this Chrome extension called Glance Back. And Glance Back, once a day when you open a new tab, it takes a photo of you. You don't have time to look cute. It's just however you look looking at your screen. It asks you what you're thinking about, and then you write that, and you eventually collect a long log of small moments that you've shared with your computer. So here's, I've been using this for like 3 years. I have a lot of terrible photos of myself. These are actually from the past couple of months. I'm not totally sure what all is in there, so we're gonna keep scrolling. but I released this publicly, and it now has over 1,000 people using it, which is not that many, but it's been really special. People will send me their photos of these like very small moments of their day that it captures, and it's really meaningful for me to see that. So here are two of my close friends. These are theirs. So I still use this every day. And the second piece that I most recently did in 2021 was a billboard that I was commissioned to create for Asian American Heritage Month. And when they proposed a billboard, the immediate first thing that I thought of was gospel billboards, which if you've ever like driven through America, this is kind of the vibe of what they look like. So I told people, I had a few different ideas of what I would create, and I told some people, I was like, oh, I have this idea, but I obviously won't do this because it's so silly, and they're like, I think you should do it. And so that gave me confidence to do it. So I made this, and this was up in Pittsburgh for a month in May. And if you call the number, there's a recording of me. That's me on the side also when I was younger. There's a recording of me, and I'll pick up, and I'll talk to you about the model minority myth. And the more I've talked to people about this, it's a phrase that was commonly known in communities I was a part of, but is not that commonly known. And you can leave a voicemail after you listen to it. And I've got all these amazing voicemails from people who had personal experiences and encounters with the model minority myth to people who had never even heard the word before. And that was really meaningful to me. So, oh, and then... I thought this was so funny. There was an article, and then the headline was, "Does art need to be ugly to affect change?" And then there was 12-year-old me. So where I'm going with this is I've had a lot of experience working with dance that was always really natural for me, but with my focus here in this program, I'm actually hoping to move away from focusing on dance specifically and focusing more instead on, going back to Goffman, the presentation of self in everyday life, but specifically online, and specifically within these themes that I process a lot by making arena channels, so these are some of them, thinking about girlhood and influencer burnout and work and worth. And I've also been thinking recently a lot about women artists who performing hyperfemininity, and this has a long history in media art. And I was really compelled at the start of 2020 by the way that I saw my younger cousins using TikTok. They were both 11 when they started using the app, both girls, and I saw them learn how to perform femininity for the camera in a way that I knew they were observing from people older than them online. And so I decided that I was going to create this alter ego via a TikTok profile named Jade. And going back to Goffman again, he talks a lot about the front stage and the backstage in terms of social settings. For me, the TikTok profile was the front stage, and I created this website as the backstage, where I document everything from all of the TikTok videos, and I would write about them and my experience with making them, the labor that goes into it. I would take drafts and drafts before I posted a single video, so I kept track of all of those too, how much things cost that I bought to wear, that kind of thing. But I wanna end by sharing what was maybe the most interesting thing that happened to me while I was doing it. I was randomly on the cover of the New York Post after I got my vaccine, just because they like happened to take a photo of me after I got it. And I thought, oh, wouldn't it be funny if I just posted this on TikTok as this character and said, oh, do you think I look like this girl?
And look at this picture. Look at the girl on the cover.
Okay, now look at me.
Do we look alike?
So I posted this and I was like, okay, everyone is obviously going to say you're the same person. And then everyone started commenting no. And they were like, you don't look alike at all. And then this person was like, honest opinion, you look better. And I was like, I don't even know how to handle that. And then, then someone said, that's racist. Not all Asians look the same, which was also interesting. And then someone I went to college with commented and said, who knows me? And they were like, not really. So that sent me into a whole identity crisis. But this project was really special to me, and I think I had a lot of complications with the way I had gone about it at first, and I'm looking for mentorship on that while I'm here and hoping to pick that back up. I'm out of time, so thank you for listening. Any questions? Yeah, there were definitely some people who, common critiques of it are that, you know, why is the model, like, the stereotypes of Asians are so positive, like being good at math, that kind of thing, you know, why is that a negative thing? Interestingly, some people had, didn't feel that the word myth was right, and the word myth was not something that I just came up with. It's kind of the way a lot of people talk about the idea of the model minority in the U.S., but it does have some interesting connotations. So there was feedback on that too.
A Lugolfin book is great, but it describes an always, completely forgotten media environment, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering if you're looking at other contemporary sociologists or other media theorists right now who are kind of since performativity is such a huge part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally. So I cut a lot of quotes because I was worried about time. A person who's writing that I really love right now is Gia Tolentino, and she references Goffman a lot, but she really repositions that theory in the age of the internet, which is more relevant to my work now. And I've also, I'm reading the Age of Surveillance Capitalism, which also informs the way I think a lot about the way that we connect and interact online. And the motivation behind the performance in many ways. In terms of artists, I look to Lynn Hirschman Leeson with Roberta Brightmore, Molly Soda, Amalia Ullman. These are Anne Hirsch, people who are really interested in exploring femininity online and have gone about it in different ways, but always in a way that centers performance in some of their pieces. So. I'm really excited about the shows here because I don't think I've had the opportunity yet to be able to really create a space, a physical space for my work to live. So I am really interested in that, but I'm interested in creating a space that centers the digital work. So kind of a home for it rather than the work being anything physical in the space itself necessarily.
was that? Hot mic. Hi, am I doing something?
I keep getting that feedback, yeah.
Yeah.
No, I mean, it's gone pretty hot all of a sudden. Let me check something. No, you're good.
Okay.
I don't know if anyone, did anyone catch it? I don't know.
I feel like every time I come up to it, it like wants to, I gotta move my phone.
Vibrational energy, you know, or something. Well, it's micing us. So that's good.
Sure. Da 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 da. What do you mean by introducing a slide? Just like talk right now? Okay. Hi, hello everyone. How you doing? I'm doing all right. I'm hoping this works, this presentation. Is that better? Yeah, aside from the feedback, it's like sounds better. Okay, good. Yes, I think so. Oh. Okay, I didn't know if you meant like the number three or also any type of indication of a three. Yeah, I do prefer it that way. Yeah, it's not a big deal if it's not there, but I do try to put it in wherever I can. Yeah. Okay.
That's the problem.
So my presentation might go to like 12 minutes or so, because I do like a land acknowledgement in the beginning, but I haven't gotten it under 10 minutes yet.
Testing one, two, testing one.
Okay.
Let me check something. Testing one, two, testing one, two. Testing one, two, testing one, two. Testing one, two, testing one, two. Testing one, two. Okay, so can you, Helen, could you just speak into the microphone a second? It's bizarre, but I'm only getting mono.
You're only hearing from this side? Can you hear it from that side over there? It was fine earlier. Did something change?
One second. I think it's always been like that. Let's play some Bob Marley quickly. Okay, so we're getting stereo from that, which tells me that it's something to do. That's weird though, I see the mic coming in. Huh. Strange. Yeah, absolutely. So just, I'll just keep say something. Okay. I'm going to just pan the mics left and right.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm getting audio from those speakers, so.
Right.
I'm just trying to figure out.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, let's see. I'm just going to keep talking. Okay, yeah, that's a thing. That's happening. It's funny. I can never think of what to say. Yeah, it sounds like it's gone now. I'm not hearing my voice over the speakers. Probably for the best, but just to keep rambling here. Oh, there it goes again. Still sounds a little feedbacky. It must be me, I don't know. I blame myself. Okay.
And I'm pretty sure we had stereo.
Okay. Okay.
Ooh. Hey.
Hey. I'm going to talk over your presentation.
Perfect. Please.
I'm going to present your slides for you. Okay.
Just turn it off, sorry.
Okay. Testing 1, 2.
Again? Okay, hello, everybody. All right, this is my first time looking at the deck in this way. I think I can read it. The text is a little small at the bottom. Oh well, what are you going to do? Too late now. Okay, yeah, good. All right, that's always helpful. Da, 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 da. All right, okay, I can hear something there.
Okay.
Oh, who, me?
I just want to make sure we're getting stereo now.
Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay.
Now? That sounds right. That feels right. Okay, cool.
Oh, okay.
You need to go halfway through the presentation.
Huh.
I didn't notice, but yeah, but
the presentations were just that good.
Yeah. You started the remix.
Tearing down the house. There we go. Yes. We need a hype person. We need a person to speak over my slides. It's going to be good.
Yeah, I'm gonna give a visual description of every single one of your pictures.
Oh, perfect. Good. Mm-hmm. So what happens after the last talk? Is there just a break? Yeah, okay. Yes. I saw something about a mixer, and then I didn't know if that was the same thing as the...
I think it's the same thing.
Okay. They're one and the same. All right. Good. I'll have time to eat that sandwich. No. I've just been waiting, just been... staring at it. Thank you.
You're using your laptop, that's why. Can you set your resolution to 1920
by
1080? Because I can't stream your content.
Yeah.
By default, it's probably onto the projector, which is 1920 by 1200. So there you go. Is it unscaled? Oh, it's a gather windows.
Gather windows.
And one behind it. Scaled, and a bit it's a bit unscaled. Change that to 1080p. Now I can stream it.
Oh, cool. Okay. Oh. Yeah, there you go. Deal. Should I go? Oh, okay. Oh, okay. I didn't know if you were going to do a thing. So I'd like to start with a land acknowledgement. I acknowledge that the land is a deeply complex being, alive, intelligent, dangerous, and sacred, amongst whom many other organisms derive their being. The land has its own ontology, customs, poetics, ethics, aesthetics, memory, and relationship to time separate from any human notions. This land is a relative, an unchi, or grandmother, that nurtures us completely and teaches us in profound and challenging ways, and therefore is not an inanimate object to be owned. You would not buy or sell your grandmother. But a sense of kinship, of home and familiarity can grow in time with another being through a relationship of care, respect, and listening. Over millennia, the Chumash and Gabrielino Tongva people have built a sacred relationship with this land we currently occupy. They are the indigenous peoples of this land. Tavangar is the name they use to refer to their Ihohinkam, or relative. Their relationship to Tavangar is ancestral. Their creation stories trace back like umbilical cords to every hill and valley around us. The bones and flesh of their Hanukvatam, or ancestors, have for hundreds of generations enriched the soil the concrete colony of Los Angeles paves over. As kin, they have inherited a sacred responsibility to care for and protect the land as a loved one. I pray that they are able to once again fully honor this ancestral commitment to cherish their Ihohinkam, or relative, unfettered by the snares of their current colonial reality. Chante wa shtea na pechi yuz apilo. Toka ki wanka hokshila he miye. Babi jo smith III of machi apilo. Unchi ichi api ki makoshi wa shtewi na iana we ichi api ki Tracy Ketterling. Unchi na ina ki honk papa na ohenumpa lakota we ya. Nana ichi api ki Barbara Smith na ate we ichi api Babi jo smith II. Nana na ate Hawasapa na hanke Seminole, na hanke Cherokee, Iash Maglawa hanke Malakota, na hanke Hamasapa yelo. Los Angeles el wati, Iash iyan Waslaha, North Dakota, na Minneapolis, Minnesota mataha. Ampretu ki le iwaha wopila ichichi apilo. Greetings everyone, my name is Bobby Joe Smith III. I am a Black and Indigenous graphic designer, photographer, videographer, programmer, and educator. I brought all of those identities with me here to UCLA to expand into a media arts practice. I appreciate you allowing me a moment to greet you in my native tongue of Lakota. I am descendant, I do so as a way of carrying on the tradition of respect for the space of learning and sharing we are building together. And because many of you may have never heard an indigenous language of this continent spoken before. As is common in the Lakota way, I also introduced you to my parents and my grandparents. Acknowledging who I come from not only honors them, it helps others orient their relationship to me and map my place within a community. I am the descendant of decorated warriors, healers, horse thieves, fugitives, educators, ranchers, drug pushers, voyageurs, and musicians. For the purposes of this presentation, I also share this lineage with you to contextualize my creative practice and reason for being here. Like the Chumash and Gabrielino Tongva, I have inherited a multi-generational struggle. to liberate and decolonize the Black and Indigenous communities I claim. This is a charge I do not take lightly, as I too am someone's ancestor. I come from warrior cultures that fought against seemingly insurmountable odds for my existence. But those warrior societies are all gone now. They become political councils, nonprofits, and law firms. The warriors have traded their weapons for briefcases, or in my case, a laptop. In the expansive terrain of this endeavor, I have pursued many paths, both personal and professional. Law, public policy, consulting, community organizing, direct action, community service. All of them have been valuable experiences that guide my steps to this day. It was in the act of making, however, that I found the most empowerment and fulfillment, despite being unable to articulate a practical or political application at the time. But I can better speak to that feeling now. In the past few years, a new path has taken shape as I've traversed the terrain between the design classrooms at MICA and RISD and the front lines of the Black Lives Matter and water protector movements in my hometowns of Minneapolis and Standing Rock. My thesis year at RISD, I began tracing the steps I'd taken upon these traversals and realized that what I thought was a path was actually a series of tributaries feeding into a vast shoal, an unmapped liminal space between water and land, perpetually in flux as each body shapes and is altered by the other. Tiffany Lethabo King refers to this place as a black shoal, a space that must be traversed slowly and with caution. This terrain's refusal of any fixed mapping has caused me to refer to it by many names. Today, I call it decolonial poetics. It has become a home for my creative practice and a vector by which to pursue the charge I've inherited as a Black and Indigenous person. My use of decolonial poetics hinges on the understanding that I do not use the term decolonization metaphorically or as a blanket term for other social justice projects. Decolonization, as explained by Eve Tuck and Kay Wayne Yang, is the rematriation of indigenous land and life through the dismantling of colonial systems of domination, expropriation, and violence. It is also important to note that my work focuses primarily on a specific form of colonization, settler colonialism, as it has manifested in the United States. I include in this definition the abolitionist efforts of Black communities, as slavery was an inseparable facet of settler colonization in the United States. It is dangerous to use the word decolonization in a way that strips it of what such an action requires. As Frantz Fanon in The Wretched of the Earth warns, decolonization, which sets out to change the order of the world, is clearly an agenda for total disorder. It never goes unnoticed, for it focuses on and fundamentally alters being. So why poetics as opposed to a well-thrown brick? Let us not hold these grammars in opposition. Creation and destruction, success and failure, colonization and decolonization are not binaries or poles along an array, but rather living terrains sharing the same space. The etymology of poetics comes from the ancient Greek utterance poesis, meaning the activity in which a person brings something into being that did not exist before. That is what is so empowering about what we do as artists and designers. Through our practices, we develop symbiotic relationships with poetics, failure, doubt, the unknown. What manifests by making those spaces kin will be essential to the process of becoming what lies beyond decolonization. In the way that a chrysalis is not a home for a caterpillar, decolonization is not a final destination for the colonized. Decolonization is a method of transformation that leads us to something else entirely. It is a process, a relearning, a ritual, a prayer, a collective act of undoing and becoming, and where it leads is yet to be made familiar. Through colonization, Black and Indigenous people know what it means to be undone. We are post-apocalyptic. The grammars of decolonial poetics are stars by which to navigate an unknowable terrain. There isn't a single trajectory, there are multitudes. Tiffany Lethabo King posited a certain vector in writing. Because conquest ushered in such a world-altering rupture, It is almost impossible for the human imagination to fully conceive of the reach of its violence. Beyond the unfathomability of the scale of conquest historical violence, the fact that its violence does not cease makes it even more difficult for the critical imaginaries that produce critical social theories to contain it, or find the appropriate level of abstraction or texture to make it legible. Conquest is always changing and in flux. It is in continual need of new language and new conceptual tools, which often exist at the margins of reason and require methods found in artistic and creative production. The utterances, performances, and statements of Black abolition and Native decolonization require new words, syntax, tense, visuality, and senses. They require a transformation of the person encountering them for them to be felt and, one hopes, understood. The work of finding a grammar for conquest is an unending labor. This project of naming is never done because the relations of conquest continue right through this very moment, shaping these very thoughts. Conquest must be perpetually elaborated and interrogated with all our existing faculties, as well as the ones that have yet to be developed. I hope during my time here to find new articulations of my research in decolonial poetics. My thesis U+16E99, or Unsettling Grammars, attempts to define a new language for design through the decolonial grammars of queer, feminist, Black, and Indigenous folks, aunties, ancestors, artists, writers, organizers, scholars, and the like. Most of my work germinates from research and participation in abolitionist and decolonial projects. My practice has become a way to feed my love of learning. The process of making helps me locate my own voice in the ongoing discussions of my ancestors, particularly when the language I need is still in the process of becoming. Physical computing, web programming, photography, video, digital embroidery, experimental publishing, performance, and pedagogy are modes of expression I return to often. They are used to heal past and ongoing traumas of colonization, to recover stolen fragments and remember who we are and where we come from, to urgently respond to current struggles, to critique, to amplify guiding voices, to reorient in a terrain that is so easy to go astray, and to set vectors for possible futures, to become, to conjure, manifest, dream, and conspire with future ancestors. These are all articulations of decolonial poetics, grammars echoing across the vast terrain. Lastly, I'd like to end with a reading from poet Alexis Pauline Gums in Octavia Butler's Brood, that in many ways articulates all I've been trying to say more compellingly and in less words. Often in moments of hushed communion, we have seen elders wipe away the taste of revolution trickling down our chin with a warning. We cannot go back to the old ways. Those ways being a time and place before the levees broke, psychological and otherwise, washing away and submerging beneath the white caps the best parts of us. Drowning, we lament our current truth. Since we cannot go back, we place our children on our back and scoop up our cherished songs and stories and sense of self in our arms, carrying all that we can bear from our past into our future. We visit our ancestors through ceremony and prayer and conjure those still in the process of becoming through poetic practices, varied, prescient, and prophetic. When we are fettered in place, unable to move backwards or forwards, we expand to encompass all our relations. Therefore, self should be understood as a vessel open to time and fueled by presence, where presence is as multiple as it is singular. This is what Black feminist scientists called integrity, a standard for affirming the resonance of presence across time, where action was equal to vision, embodied through variables. Thank you. Any questions?
Well, that was powerful. I just want to do that, like,
Oh, good. Thank
you. Thanks. So it's just a kind of like a very obvious question, but you know that So we live in a very high technology environment at GMA. So what kind of plans do you have to sort of like apply your thinking to certain kind of, shall we say, like technological possibilities and so that this program works?
Absolutely. Yeah, so I'm coming from a graphic design background, and throughout that practice, I found myself trying to expand into areas that I didn't quite have the capabilities of yet, nor the time, or the resources, or the help to help guide me. The things I had maybe considered more media arts and would probably want to show here oftentimes didn't work. And there's nothing more frustrating than going to a crit and not being able to have the thing operate the way that you want to. But what I find very interesting to me about media arts is the ability to create simulation, to be able to have people completely immersed in something. And I think that's going to be very important for people who are pursuing decolonization. We need spaces where we can be able to commune with one another, to practice what it means to be free, or to get free, or to dismantle. How can we do those things in reality? When we try to, violence is enacted upon us. So how can we create these digital spaces in which we can practice and operate and commune? Or how can we create places where we can learn with one another? I think that's what or sometimes you can't even think of what a possible future is because there's an edifice in the way. So how can art shift our thinking or bring us to a different place that opens up the possibilities? And that's really what I wanna, that's what I wanna try here. There's some grammars that I think are very valuable that I wanna center in my making, and just see what becomes of them. I think it will. One of the big questions that I had and still have, and one of the reasons why I came here, and I've spoken with Lauren about this, is how do I bring my practice home? How do I get home from here? I mean, a lot of people know about the financial situation for students in the US. There's a financial burden that comes from going to schools like this, which prevent me from being able to go back to a place that is impoverished. So how do I make work that doesn't just end up in galleries, but I can bring back home? And that's one of the things I'm going to try to figure out. How do I make from this institution? How do I make from LA work that's supposed to impact North Dakota and South Dakota? That's something I'll have to figure out. There is a pretty large Native population here. There's a lot of Native celebrities out here, which will be fun to collaborate with because a lot of them are artists in some ways, you know, musicians and things like that. So I'm interested to see how that goes. And I'm getting the sign to stop. So thank you all very much. I'd love to hear more questions and suggestions at another time. Oh. I think this one was here. Prior. And that connects to that. And I'll switch it back.
No, this is the one. Oh, can you hear me? Does this work? Okay, cool. Thank you. Okay. Hi, my name is Krista Ramirez-Villatoro. I am from Guatemala. That is my background. My other background is in filmmaking. For most of my undergrad, I did a lot of work in documentary film. So actually, let me go back on this. I'm just gonna play my reel while I talk, and hopefully that works. A lot of my work was extremely personal to me. I did a lot of work with the migrant caravan from Central America, which was a group of about like 2,000 people that decided to make the walk from their Central American countries to the United States, and were kind of reached an impasse at the border, and that's kind of where we met up with everyone. I also did a lot of work with gun violence, which was something that is apparently pretty prevalent in Colorado, where my family is located, and also a personal experience to me. But after speaking on all these things about myself, the one identity that I took a long time to really learn how to express was my disability. I have an acquired disability. I suffered a spinal cord injury at the age of 6 due to a tumor in my spinal cord. And I wanted to make films about that, and I used the medium of film, but I found it profoundly limiting because I felt that whenever people watched these films, what the feeling it conveyed was inspiration, which was not what I was going for at all. The disability experience is one that is extremely painful and extremely limiting, and just one that not a lot of people relate to, and it felt can't think of the English word. And it just it was not what I wanted for my practice. So that's when I made the shift into art, and I started building to kind of give able-bodied individuals the feeling of what it means to live in a broken body, and also grieve and still live in that body which is broken. I don't know if that made sense. So this is my first piece that happened during the pandemic, Pav Machina. It simulates what eye contact feels like for a person that just by design has to experience the world 3 feet off the ground. So I built this in my garage with my brother. I think he's about 5'9". So the whole purpose of the design is to make the able-bodied individual really have to bend and squirm and try to figure out how you can look at yourself from that perspective. Because as someone sitting in a wheelchair, it is a little bit dehumanizing to have to A, look at butts all day, B, have to look up at everyone at all times like you're a child. So this was my first installation piece, and that was what it was trying to convey, and I think it was pretty successful. And then from there, I started shifting into other mediums, and I'm still very much experimenting with mediums to see how I can keep telling the story. So this is something I made in the height of the pandemic. People were still unvaccinated, so I really couldn't go see my friends. So what I would do is I bought a ton of VR headsets, and I drove to their houses, and I dropped them off. And I just sent them this link so we could kind of recreate the experience of skateboarding together, which was something that they were all doing, but I couldn't be a part of because I was immunocompromised. This is me trying to simulate that. Hold on. Oh, let me move it. Sorry. It's just really cool to look at, aside from what it means. So now that I am in this program, I feel like I have a little bit more of a platform to really speak on the socio-political implications of disability. And there's a lot of questions and a lot of research that I want to go into, and some topics that are particularly difficult and uncomfortable and just overall hard. And I have a list of the things that I want to look into, and hopefully my goal is to receive mentorship from all these amazing people in here, and how to really conceptualize this into interactive pieces, whatever that might manifest into. But I think one of those topics that I really want to talk about is women and disabilities, and just like the fact that we have a we are 7 times more likely to be sexually assaulted than able-bodied women. It's just a really hard statistic to really deal with, and just within my community, it is very real. I also really want to deal with the objectification that we face as a community, where able-bodied people take our narratives and just use them as drive to deal with their very hard lives. But at the same time, we are, we are not given autonomy of ourselves through conservatorships, which is something that has been in the news lately because of Britney Spears. So I'm glad that was brought to light. I wish it would have been brought to light in a different way. And also marriage equality, of not being able to receive benefits from the government if we choose to marry a partner that makes a certain income, things like that. And the thing that is closest to my heart at the moment is the absolute massacre that was the pandemic, when the message was sent out that the virus would only affect those with disabilities and the elderly, and how we were completely forgotten about from that moment on. So my goal is to bring us back into the conversation, because it is pretty obvious that people are not going to see us if they're not talking about us. And it feels a little bit ironic to be at a campus that doesn't, where the signs are all around that accessibility isn't really a priority. I started working on this week, and I was like debating putting it on here, but I started building a map. I don't know if it's true. Psychogeography, of points of inaccessibility around campus, of just things that within my first week, I tried to walk from Westwood all the way up to this building, and I just couldn't. There was no Bruin Walk or something. The ramps don't connect. So I just walked back and drove up here, and that seems to be what's going to end up happening for the rest of my time here. But I'm really excited to make some really impactful work, and to continue talking about these my work in these topics, and seeing where it takes me, and hopefully bringing these things to light. Yes, thank you. Sorry. I'll take a couple questions. We good? No. Okay.
Coming from film, do you see yourself continuing working in a narrative way, or is it something that, how is it that the department will change that practice, or what areas, how would you?
Yes. So I actually spent the summer as the Respectability Entertainment and Media Fellow, so I got a lot of the information on disability advocacy within the entertainment field, and I am looking at animation. Oh, and how to better advocate for ourselves in this community, and how to make more accurate representation. So this is pretty cool. This is like the Strawberry Shortcake show, and it's animated after my tennis wheelchair, so it's gonna be in the show. It's pretty cool. But yeah, I will always come back to film. I think film is my first love, and I think it is the medium that creates the most change in conversations, just the way people watch films in movie theaters when they come out of them and just feel the need to create something different. That's something that I'm not going to walk away from, I don't think. So yeah. To an extent, yeah. Documentaries, a little bit smaller sets, not definitely like hundreds of people like in the entertainment industry. But yeah, I'd say in small groups, yeah. If that makes sense. Yeah. Cool.
A lot of times, yeah, a lot of teammates work individually.
Yeah.
Sometimes people do work collaboratively or find collaborators up on campus, and I was thinking about how you imagine.
Yeah, I think, like, especially with my disability, I think working collaboratively is kind of a given. I will be needing help, and it's hard to admit and hard to ask for, but I know that I will be needing it. Yeah. Yeah, sorry. That's really it. We're good? Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry.
Warm, yeah. Hi. It's not getting it?
No, you probably, I think you pressed the right button. I think this computer is sleeping. Let's give it a second. There you should.
Yeah, I could have gone here, but.
Switch the input to something else and then switch that. Switch the bus there. Can I borrow this? Sorry. Huh? Media arts, right here. I'm gonna turn the projector off and back on because everything should be working. But it's a new projector, so maybe it doesn't like receiving different signal.
It gives me a minute to get set up.
So is your mic still on?
Yeah.
Oh no. Oh my gosh. We've killed the projector.
Yeah, I can use my own laptop. Maybe that's easiest.
Sure, Henry. Yeah, let's try that. Although it shouldn't. Yeah, it shouldn't make a huge difference. Sometimes.
It's not doing it.
Okay, yeah, just try that.
Yeah. This is number two.
Number two?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Nah, it happens. Oh, yeah, I guess I got a sign. Yeah.
Oh, maybe. Maybe. Well, hang on a minute. One second.
And that's what this is labeled as.
It's connected.
Should I try the
number three?
No.
I mean, it doesn't seem to.
You're plugged in number two, right?
Yeah.
Try three, since that's the one that we've just been using.
Yeah.
Oh God, you're gonna pull it off. That's really tight. How many more is there?
So now I'm on three.
So now you're on three. Okay. Can you check your displays settings to see if it's actually seeing the projector as a display? I didn't. One and two. Can you scroll down a second? All right. I think we're gonna need to have a little break because I can't fix this. All right. Hey, I'm gonna call a tech break for 10 minutes because I'm gonna have to get the ladder out, and it's gonna be difficult to do with everyone in here. So we're gonna have to have an extra break. Yeah. Sorry about that.
I mean, it's so, not like reacting to the.
Yeah, so what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna bring the ladder out, check the inputs on the back out there. Nothing's changed, so like, it's been working. Sorry? May have to, yeah. May have to.
Yeah, it's like, it's not, it's here.
Jennifer, what's going on? Power of what? Of the which switch?
The HDMI switch.
Here, let me help you. We don't need to do it. We can just power the whole thing now. Let me just power the whole thing now. Okay. Let me just power the whole thing down. I'm pretty sure this is something not to do with cables. No, just because nothing's been touched and it was working fine for the first half and nothing's changed. We've not pulled anything, we haven't changed anything. So it would seem to me like a technology fail rather than a cabling fail. What I can do, there might be a pop right now. What's your ears? A bit of a pop. It can be many reasons. It can be this, it can be this, it can be this, it can be this.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was.
It can be lots of things.
Mac can be, Mac is one. Mac is usually one.
Say that again?
Mac, the Mac computer is usually
one. Yeah, I know.
I'm plugged into three now with my laptop, but
Let me
I'll move this
back on. We're gonna reset.
Oh.
system's been solid for several years, but I just replaced the projector. Yeah. So I suspect it's that. I suspect that Epson doesn't like receiving different inputs. At the same time, it's actually only one signal going to the projector. Yeah. It's not multiple, but it's only one. So it's actually here that all the switching's happening.
Yeah.
So that's kind of weird. Let's see. Could also be the HD base T, I suppose. Yeah, nothing had happened, just the projector crapped out. Which one to use, your laptop or the... The projector crapped out. Well, sorry, forget that. Probably wasn't the projector, it was probably one of those devices crapped out. Meaning broke, failed. Not physical, but like it's nothing. There's nothing wrong with the system. It's just technology in there needed restarting.
It's like HDMI kind of like says, like when you connect HDMI, it gets like, hey, I'm a projector, like, hey, I'm
right.
A computer, and then like sometimes if you do that too many times in a row, it kind of is like.
Right, and actually now it's not even just, we're using this other thing now. HDCP, yeah, the whole thing. I think just something crapped out.
Yeah, it seems like it. Well, that's cool because then I can like do my own.
Yeah, I just needed a restart. I really just needed a restart.
I mean
yes, cool.
I need to.
But,
that's good because then I can move my Windows around.
No, I know, but I still see the new projector. I'm hoping it's not projector.
But this is. Yeah, go ahead. But this is good because I had to like drag the windows around a little bit, so yeah, nice intro there.
Alright, well, thanks for
yeah.
Patience. Welcome to the EA. Seriously, we had years.
Yeah.
Didn't even have to come up here.
We were like,
literally before COVID for at least 2 years, solid, no issues. But you know, you replace technology,
mm-hmm.
I replaced this. I replaced the mixer. The mixer broke earlier, and it was pushing mono rather than stereo.
Oh yeah.
To change the resolution on this. So for you to know, we have to have it at 1080p,
right.
Otherwise we can't stream.
Right.
That also could be part of the issue.
Yeah, well now it's blue screening, I suppose.
Yeah, that could be the part of the issue. That might be it. That's it. Found the issue.
Crazy.
Found the issue. That's what it is. All right, well, this should fix it.
Well, or...
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Wow. Interesting. Interesting. Wow.
It's just loud touch with the... Because the projector isn't doing
anything. Oh, you know what it is? Yes. Yeah. Minimum. At least, sorry, maximum. So I just realized something. It's still it's optimizing it as a Canon.
Oh yeah.
But it's an Epson. So the Mac is seeing it as the wrong projector. So
but
that's
it's also saying.
That's this.
Oh, yeah, that's
so we're gonna have to restart again. Sorry. I think it might be the Mac actually, not the projector. Mm-hmm. It's the Mac. It's the Mac interfacing with the projector. That's
yeah.
Is the Canon what it used to be?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. It was pretty What's that?
Projector off. Yeah, just give it some time. I just restarted it. So.
Oh, right.
Anyway, I'm confident it's going to work. It's just we're not going to be able to stream it, which is fine. Helen, the stream's not going to work anymore. Meaning she'll hear the audio. That's just not true. The stream will continue, but my screen sharing to the streaming station is not going to work. Which, to be honest with you, if Victoria's listening, she's hearing me say that right now anyway. Because we're still pushing this thing. Yeah, but it's not going to be very good because it's just going to be from the house camera. But she'll still see everyone talk.
I don't know if I use my laptop, but
it's not
going to
change it. No,
it's
not that. And we know what the issue is. It's as soon as we change away from the native resolution, it doesn't like it.
Oh, yeah. And I can't stream it from my laptop.
Right.
It's going to take a minute.
And the fact that it sees a different computer is a weird thing. Do you want it mirrored or
unmirrored? Yeah, I want it like that. Unmirrored, yeah.
Unmirrored?
Not. No? Is it doing it again?
We'll see.
Oh,
you have to restart one more time.
It does that every time you change the resolution, I guess.
Yeah. One last time.
Yeah, so if we don't change resolution, I should be good, right?
I hope so.
Yeah.
I hope so. I'm going to turn this off again. Could also be the switch that it's going to as well, because we turned this off earlier as well, so we may have to turn that off again.
But if it's I guess because you put it in like 1920 by 1200,
so it should keep it now. Yeah,
it keeps it. We're good.
Oops. Let it boot up. Oh, I know. Okay, we're good. Displays, arrangement. It's still seeing it, even though it's... Because it's...
Open up my thing. While we're waiting for the projector.
Are you feeling confident now?
I mean, I'm kind of like, I mean, I used to be on the other side of it, like trying to help people.
Right.
So, it's not super weird.
No, same problem. Let me do one last thing. Say that again, sorry? Oh, there we go. There we go. Flashing.
It's flashing, but it's like it's flashing on the display here, but it's not
doing
anything.
Yeah.
Projector. Oh. Do you want to try your laptop real
quick?
Yeah. Fixed it, turning everything off, turn everything back on again.
Right. Let's take a minute to set up. This is a restaurant that my great uncle worked at back in the 50s when he came over here to work, Uncle Lennart. It's not around anymore, unfortunately. He claims to have met Marilyn Monroe and Elizabeth Taylor, and because it was right on Sunset, so it was close to all the studios. So he claims. Let me see, I'm gonna put my window in there. This is a little awkward, but here we go. I am on the Wi-Fi, but it's not. It doesn't seem to be like working very well.
You can plug in the LAN cable too if you want.
Oh yeah, you got one?
Yeah, just grab that white one there.
Great.
There you go. Put that in.
I do actually have a.
Do you have audio?
I do. Yeah.
Okay, grab.
Oh yeah, the jack cable.
Is this your audio out
here? This computer is so new, so I don't even know. I think it's right. Yeah, it's right there.
Okay. And just check that it's not pushing through the HDMI. Sometimes
yeah.
The audio will try and push through the HDMI.
Yeah, it's pushing. It's the headphones now, so it's cool.
Okay.
All right. What's up?
Because it'll still default through the Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
You connected. You should be. So try. Try just another a random.
Yeah.
A random browser.
Okay. Yeah, it's cool. Right. So maybe I'll just redo this from the top.
Okay. Sorry, everyone. This is mostly not my fault, but.
Right.
Cool. Hello, my name is Henrik. I'm from Sweden. I haven't defined any specific goals for my studies in this presentation. It's going to be an outline of my interests and exemplified by some works. And these are also the things I'm really interested in pursuing here at DMA. Sort of a trigger warning, one of the works I'm presenting discusses suicide, so be aware of that if you need to. This is a work from my bachelor degree show, which I held this spring. It's called Dunya, and it consisted of a dual channel video installation. So it's got a projection and a screen there. And it's programmed in Unity. And it also had this sculptural piece in the foreground. One channel of the video, this 2D scene that's hopefully gonna start up here, is populated by characters that have a name and random attribute. I'm going to keep talking until it starts. All right. This is a scene with populated by characters represented by small white squares, which we'll hopefully see in a minute, that have a randomly generated name and randomly generated attributes, and they interact with each other in different ways. The console logger narrates what happens in the scene. If a character gets killed, there's a chance they'll be resurrected as a ghost simultaneously in the 2D world and the 3D video, which is a rendition of the gallery space where the work was exhibited. And it looks like this. I'm probably gonna need a buffer as well. This room is watched over by two angel characters, and the ghosts in this room move restlessly and aimlessly, stopping sometimes to turn on the scent diffuser, which was connected to its physical equivalent in the gallery space. With each ghost that spawns, there is also the increasing chance of a moon appearing, drawing in and destroying a number of ghosts. I don't know if you have time to wait for this to buffer, unfortunately. This sucks, but I'm going to have to move on, I guess. Oh, there we go. Cool. So, yeah, these are the ghosts in the middle that are generated in both spaces simultaneously. Sorry, I'm going to have to go ahead. The work was inspired by many things. Espen Aarseth's notion of cybertext, which is one, it's a text that alters itself through the process of reading. And this concept fundamentally applies to computer games, but also to like the tarot or the I Ching, I guess. I was also intrigued by the pandemonium architecture model for machine learning, which was developed by Oliver Selfridge in the late 50s, and its characterization of its nodes as demons. Also, another point of inspiration was like digital and internet-based folklore, like haunted multiplayer maps or the liminal spaces and the backrooms phenomena, which is like a Tumblr thing. A general theme emerged of digital technology overlapping with the language and concept of the spiritual or mystical. I also drew from game theory discussions on narrative and ludology, and where game storytelling should be scripted or strictly gameplay-based and generative. Simply by naming these characters and giving them rudimentary attributes and narrating their totally random generative interactions, I found that many spectators became very engrossed with the goings on of this extremely crude and abstract story. And the unpredictable appearance and like random movements of the ghost in the 3D room created attention and anticipation, and the console log became a quite poetic text in its own right. Ultimately, the takeaway of this work for me was an investigation into how humans use fiction and archetypal narratives to make sense of systems that may be unknown or opaque. The lore that I created made people react and empathize with these ultimately like abstract white dots and their totally randomly generated lives. So let's see. About 10 years ago, I started printmaking at a pre-undergrad art education, and these are some of my works from that time. Even earlier, at around age 14, I started to experiment with electronic noise music. Both these mediums are unified in that they require a certain understanding of technological processing in addition to an aesthetic sensibility. And this is my studio back then. I think these influences form the basis of my practice in art using and referencing technology. A common tactic in noise music is creating a feedback loop by connecting the output from a mixing desk back into its own input. This creates a continuous, very loud signal which overloads the circuit, distorting and modulating the sound. The system can then be played by changing the volume or effect settings, but it is extremely unpredictable. One thing that has always fascinated me about this mode of playing music is that it's not physically played like traditional instruments, but it also differs from a lot of programmed electronic music since it's not written or organized in any way beforehand, before the performance. This process of making music centers around setting up a generative system, i.e. the feedback loop, and the performance is more like administering or monitoring or reacting to that system, like improvising with a machine partner. Similarly, in games, for example, systematized randomness is used to tell a story of non-scripted events generated through, for example, code or dice throws. In the work Dunya, I tried to convey a story using a system of simple rules, interacting modules, and random generation. This is what I refer to as generativity when I talk about it, and as a concept that also ties back to electronic and experimental music and like John Cage and Karlheinz Stockhausen. Sorry. In my senior year solo show, I utilized several unsynchronized audio and video live streams, or no, sorry, not live streams, several unsynchronized audio and video tracks, I should say, with the aim of creating a spatial environment where the mix of the different elements depended on chance, the varying lengths of the different loops, and where the spectator positioned themselves in the room. This was an attempt to create a generative additive effect in space rather than in like digital, in physical space rather than in digital space, you know. Thematically, the show dealt with topics of death and memory through focusing on digital and analog information technology and internet culture. Quotes from discussions on suicide from message boards such as Reddit and 4chan, as well as YouTube comment threads, were synthesized and recorded onto analog tape. These anonymous discussions range from support to encouragement to ridicule, but I was touched by their ephemerality. We have at times been warned that once something gets put on the internet, it's there forever, but I think the opposite is just as true. Anything on the internet can disappear forever at any given time, certainly in the case of Reddit, where message boards with suicidal or self-harm content were routinely removed. In this way, someone's last words, or inversely, the advice that saved someone's life could be arbitrarily deleted and lost forever. I wanted to preserve these voices in a setting without moral judgment. I also liked the idea of putting these ephemeral digital messages onto analog tape, a medium which, on the one hand, seems durable due to its simplicity and physicality, but also is subject to mechanical erosion every time it is played, eventually drowning out the recording in noise. And this, we probably won't have time to buffer this. So that was an animation that was part of the show, which you can see on my website or something. The show also featured a local server which hosted an old school PHP message board, which was accessible through a Wi-Fi inside the gallery. The message board served as a guest book and like an archival dump for contextual material. So we have Basia and Adar there that I reference in this video. So another project. Having been involved in DIY music since my teens, matters of self-organization and independence from capital are also important to me. This is an attempt to continue the traditional fanzines in the digital realm. I co-edited this BitTorrent-based art publication called Momok. The publication consisted of different media, was writing, images, sound, software, and was presented in subfolders like this so the user could freely explore. The project was an experiment in alternate distribution forms besides the centralized big data platforms, but also in like using the desktop as a site for art presentation. Let's see. Okay, yeah. Another aspect of being part of larger economic political superstructures that I've been pondering is media technology and its effects on the ecosphere. In the summer of 2020, I held this virtual performance lecture, Polygon Ecology, I call it, at Index Foundation in Stockholm. It was an attempt at a polemic against the ideology of upgrade in media and computers, better graphics, more visual effects, higher resolutions, constantly requiring new high-end graphics processors and monitors. I tried to map things like the power consumption of running 3D games or the high ecological impact of chip manufacture to argue for an artist aesthetic degrowth. I argued that artists and designers could use sound and music, innovative game design and storytelling to create an expressive game experience without defaulting to high detail graphics, allowing for degrowth in the computer parts industry. So, in conclusion, I'm interested in technology, how we use it, and the social and ecological and political implications of its use. I tend to approach a lot of these topics as systems to understand, utilize, and possibly change them. Such systems can be linguistic, political, economical, technological, they can be sets of aesthetics or game rules. Ultimately, I believe that these systems are connected on the macro level, and starting from a critical view of technology is one way of trying to approach a whole. Thank you. Yeah, I curated them myself. I just went in these spaces, and there was also like YouTube comments from songs and things that I already, you know, liked. So some of it came to me, some of it I sought out, but yeah, I manually collected it. Yeah, I personally need the installation I showed in the beginning was utilizing a simplistic 3D aesthetic, but technically I don't think it's like simplistic enough to actually be like backwards compatible. So something I'm interested in exploring here is like the technological method of creating something that's compatible with these older machines, or maybe bridging the gap between new and old hardware and technology. I'm coming at it from like a design perspective. Up until now, I've been coming at it from a design perspective where I think about how other modes of expression can be used instead of like photorealistic high definition graphics. And that gaming is like, I'm zooming in on gaming as like one aspect of media technology, but it also applies to like 4K streaming, which I think is probably ultimately pretty unnecessary. On some level, most of what I've known, I come from a fine arts bachelor, I graduated this spring, and most of what I did there, I had to learn myself. So I feel like I could, on one level, I'm excited to have a foundation of expertise here where I can learn things in, a more firm foundation in what I'm interested in. And both theoretical and practical. Does that answer your question, maybe? Yes. Always. Yeah. What's that?
How is the virtual game world
made? The lecture? It was made in Unity. It was just using the terrain editor and a basic FPS script. So.
Okay.
But yeah, I made it. It was like, I was gonna do a PowerPoint or something, but I realized that it, like, I think it was just an idea of how to make it more fun or something, but it does make more sense to talk about the virtual world inside a virtual world, I guess. And it was streamed on Twitch as well, so. Cool. Thank you. Do you want to try to get the Mac working, or do you just want to use my computer?
Oh, okay, yeah. You can do that's okay.
Yeah, sure. You want to mirror the screen?
Yeah, no, this is fine.
Okay.
Yeah, just keep using it.
I don't trust it if you switch it out.
Yeah.
Should use Maya's side again.
Where is that? Sorry, where's the cursor?
You saw the website?
No, it's the Google Doc.
Oh,
okay. Website.
And you don't want to mirror it.
No, it's fine.
You can actually, if you go, you can. Do you have notes?
Yeah.
Click on this little arrow. Yeah. Click on the little arrow.
Yeah.
Hit that. Yeah. And then drag that over, and your notes should be here. Yeah, you can drag it that way.
Which way?
Oh, that way. Yeah. In this case.
Oh God. Where's the cursor?
I think it's the end tab.
Okay.
And if you scroll down to the bottom left, you can full screen it.
Yeah.
You can also probably just press that.
I think it's Control Shift F.
Yeah, on a PC.
Control Shift F. Wait. No?
Try Control. No, and things I don't want to. Here, let's do it the manual way. There's a little pop up that appears.
Right.
Down.
Yeah, it's like down there.
Oh man, what's this? Okay, great. Thank you.
That one.
Yeah. Okay.
And is that big enough for your notes?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really need those. So.
You don't need it? Okay.
Okay, great. All right. Hey, everyone. I'm Michael. So a bit about myself first. Pronouns are he and him. I was born in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And never went back there. I went back to Sichuan when I was 2 months old. And I spent most of my time there. I graduated DMA as an undergrad in 2020. And I'm a game designer and a game maker. I like to separate those things because the former is a commercial service that serves an audience, whereas the game maker is more for amateurs and artists to focus on personal creativity. And that for me means writing, lots of writing, designing, of course, and programming and making things physically or just by hand, and animation. So I mostly make short experimental video games slash interactive animations about my Chinese slash American identity because of the way I grew up. Those things are in constant conflict, and I have to deal with the results and their subsequent culture and history. I like building digital worlds with non-digital materials or process. And I try to challenge existing modes of game making and very commercial escapist world building practices. So let's move on to my work. So this was originally gonna be my undergrad capstone. It's a radio operator simulator, that's fun to say. It's a generational narrative across four periods of time with four embedded short stories about a single family. So really writing is kind of at the forefront of this. But it's not just a novel that you can read, you have to interact with it. It's a dual narrative between the operator, which is the player, and the messages they receive, which in turn they have to decipher to progress. And it's inspired by scar literature. I think some of you may know what that is. I'm not gonna explain it here. And the writing is a mix of feverish, folklorish, magical realism, and state documents that meshes a politically bureaucratic world with a deep history. That's just someone else's summary that's better than what I could come up with. So, and another important part of my stuff is that it tried to steer away from the traditional game mechanisms that I play a lot. It often requires some sort of physical interaction, like beyond the screen. So in this case, you have to listen to it, you have to use a pen and paper to decipher the codes. So the challenge of it happens almost entirely outside the self. Deciphering each message happens on paper. This real space, letting your actions connect you with the character in a physical way. That's also much better than what I could write for myself. So moving on to my actual undergrad capstone project. It's a short alternative walking simulator / interactive animation. And it's basically a thank you note to the forgotten matriarchs that I wouldn't be here without. And I just want to make that clear is that I'm in no position to judge or even describe their experiences. It's pure admiration. And that's it. So the interaction, it's a very crude mimicry of the sort of inland migration events that happened to my family as well as many, many other families. And no one likes to talk about them because it's a very painful period of time. So you basically alternate between these two keys to simulate walking. And it's not fun to play. None of my games are fun to play, but it's very fun for me to watch. but that's not the point. The point is it brings a physical weight to the gameplay, I guess, like instead of just pressing W to move forward. I think that's what people are used to. And that's really important. And I'm kind of always a little bit hesitant to show this because it's a very casual intro piece I just made last year when I was like kind of deciding between staying as a professional game designer or come back to grad school. So it's an experimental piece of writing and, you know, animation and game. And I don't like to talk about my work this way, but you play as an Asian American, which you can't tell because it's mono, but it talks about labor exploitation. You exploit your robots and you're also being exploited by the space trillionaires. And while you fight through your own identity crisis. I think this is a good point to talk more about outside influences, I think, especially for this one because it's a more casual work. So obviously we're on an orchard, the Grapes of Wrath, and Red Sorghum by Mo Yan, who is a very large part of the Scar Literature group I mentioned earlier. And Bullshit Jobs by David Graeber, very good book. You literally play as a taskmaster and a flunky and a goonie, I guess, in this one. And The Expanse, it's a really good series of book that talks about class and asteroid mining and space colonialism. And I usually keep other video games out of my own work. I play a lot of them, but I don't use their, you know, kind of as my inspiration, but I have to attribute this one to Paolo's Every Day the Same Dream, which is a very awesome Flash game. So most recent work, I guess, is working title, Working Everything. So it's a short linear interactive animation, which is about 8 to 9 minutes long, hopefully, about stone miners and industrial cement production back home. As you can see, it's about brutal masculinity and, you know, men's power over nature and how to deal with that now. And it's also a continuation of this sort of crude mimicry. So you basically do a mouse swipe, but you have to do hundreds of mouse swipes to progress through the animation. And if I do get to finish this piece, I'm hoping to make a fake pickaxe and just perform. Swing for, like, I think 127 times, and that'll finish the whole thing for the audience. I think I'm pretty fast, okay. As for what I want to do here, of course, more games and interactive work. I have this concept of building a game album. That's just a series of experimental games that's very short, and it's also a world-building exercise. that's, you know, connected to the themes that I'm interested in, but that's about it. This is important because I try to, you know, move away from the hours-long repetitive commercial games that are out there. But this form also allows me to, you know, explore different themes, concepts that derive different gameplays from them as I do, and to move away from 2D into 3D space. You know, each piece can be formally very different. I think it has to be formally very different. And also move away from linear storytelling to more generative procedural stuff that's, you know, more like simulations or zero player games. And also custom controllers, immersive installations that I did not get to build while I was here. So thank you. Questions? I'm kind of an outsider to this. I just started 2 years ago. All these works are pretty much my most recent work. But I did study a little bit of oil painting when I was young, but this has nothing to do with it. I'm more influenced by Anthropy, whose idea is about, you know, anyone can make a video game. And that's where all of this visual elements come from. It's like, I don't care, I just draw something down. Maybe it looks good, maybe it looks bad, but, you know, I think it looks good. But yeah, it's very spontaneous, very, you could even say chaotic. But yeah, so it's kind of this zine culture. More questions? Yeah. 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 I give feedback online, but I think I didn't get much chance to watch people physically play it, but I did when it was put on the backpack at the opening day. It was pretty fun. Like, someone was just spamming buttons on my back for like 10 minutes, and, you know, they were like, "Oh, what's this story about? It looks so good." But I can't. Why is it always making me run? I mean, it's just fun for me. I guess. Yeah. Yeah.
Have any of your family members played
it? Yes, they're the first ones I show. When it's done, yeah. And, you know, it's mostly about them at this point, yeah. They don't get it most of the times because, you know, games is kind of a taboo where I'm from, but, you know, it's about them and they kind of like it. Okay. Thank you.
What is it? No, it's fine. I think I'm just trying to figure out where my mouse is.
So now, because we had the issues with the projector, we're running it off Henrik's laptop.
Thanks, Henrik.
Let's hope his battery lasts. It looks okay right now.
Yeah.
Do you have notes on your presentation?
Yeah, but I think I will be fine without mirroring.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, you can grab them. If you do, next to the present, little arrow, the drop-down arrow, click that. Oh.
Actually,
you caught the whole thing. Are
yeah,
you sure?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. I guess. Yeah, I can.
Because we can get the notes up if you want.
I might be a little bit confused if there's like a text in it.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's as easy like this.
Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Eunice Choi. I go by she, her, hers. I'm from South Korea. It's really nice to meet everyone in person today. So I often start my presentation with my first interactive sculpture. This is a sculpture that you, that you will put your palms underneath the facet, and there will be a light projecting on your palm. And there is a motion sensor inside the facet which will trigger the sound of the water flowing, but there is no actual water in the sculpture, so there is an absence of touch. This project was important to me as it was a starting point of my interactive installation process and also using a senses as my medium. As I was interested in using five senses, I was drawn to using food ingredients as a sculpture material. This one is a sugar lighting. The glowing yellowy things are the casted sugar. I use sugar, corn syrup, and hint of vanilla extract. For this project, my initial question was whether we can eat the light. It was completely edible, but I didn't recommend any of the audience to lick it because it was attracting all the dust in the air. But if I get the right temperature with the sugar, I will get this delicious gold-looking candy. If you can see it in the right. But if I go a little bit higher with the temperature, I will burn the sugar and caramelize it, and that's the color it gets. Another project that I was using a food ingredient was the digital cookie shop performance. So this is before they changed the cookie policy. Back in 2017, whenever I use the internet in the US, I would get this pop-up notice that says this website is using your cookie to enhance your browsing experience. And I was curious and frustrated because I wasn't getting that kind of notice when I was in Korea. Also, there is only two options. Either I accept or learn more about this policy. I wasn't able to decline it. So I was a little bit frustrated and also curious about the use of the word cookie. So I made a performance with actual cookie that I will collect people's personal information through conversation. So my customers will come into my cookie shop and I will ask them whether they want to make a membership card with me. If they say yes, I will ask them questions starting from very casual ones, what kind of cookie flavor do you like? And the question will gradually go to a bit more intimate and personal, such as when was your first kiss? And I will write down all the answers to the cookie with an edible ink pen. And these are the cookies of my customers that I collected. They weren't able to get their cookie back, and these cookies were stored in my fridge. Another thing that I was interested in the art and technology department in my undergrad was making an automata. And this is one scene of the automata of the story that I made about the rock and the kite. So a little bit of the story is there was a rock, there was a kite. They become a really close friend and spend a lot of time together. But then there's a sudden wind that separates two of them. So the rock waits, thinking the kite will come back. It waits, but the kite never comes back. So the rock decides it will start its own journey to find a kite. And this automata is showing the one, well, where's my mouse? Scene of the journey, rock's journey, when it passes the flower. You can see my rock is very gentle. It didn't want it to hurt the flowers. In this project, I was curious about what would be the sculptural representation of the reading.
with the physical book, you flip the books, flip the pages to proceed the story. And here I was using the hand crank to activate the story. Oops, no. Okay. My mouse. Where is my, okay. And in my senior year, I was spending more time in the design object department. And in that department, I was able to do more material exploration. So the left image is the silicone cast I did, and right image is the resin printed mold that I use for casting silicone. So the starting point of this project was my curiosity towards this plastic bar you will see in the checkout line. So when you go to the grocery store and you want to purchase your stuff, you go to the checkout line, you put this plastic bar thingy that nobody knows the name of it, and it indicates your personal space. And I was curious about what kind of relationship and behavior happens in that small, tiny space between you and the other customer. So in the installation, I put a little servo motor underneath these round objects. So when the audience was trying to remove the bar thingy in the right image, the other objects start to vibrate like a sea animal's defense mechanism. As I was getting inspiration from sea animals' visuals and movements, I wanted to put it in the water. So in this installation, I'm putting in the waterproof pedestal with water without any motors in it. And something that was really interesting to me was seeing young audiences interacting with my piece, as it was very different from usual audiences. They were throwing my piece all around the galleries, and that was something that I wasn't expecting, but I was enjoying seeing that kind of interaction, which led me to participate in the Children's Museum of Pittsburgh residency. This was the interactive installation made for the museum. I was inspired by the tomato garden in front of the museum, and also the hidden picture activity such as Where is Waldo? So the children can touch it. This is all casted silicones. They can touch it, they can interact with it, they can also turn the wheel, and they will get one tomato assigned. She got the bear tomato, and they will go through the walls to find the bear tomatoes. So my current interest is understanding the resilience. I guess this is coming from my experiment with silicon. When I was working with silicon, I was drawn to this quality of how they respond to the pressure and how they change their forms, but not disappearing. So I'm curious to learn about what it means to have a pressure on the object or one to self, or what it means, why we become a pressure to ourselves, how do we change and mold ourselves within the pressure. I think the stretchiness or squishiness has some kind of humorous quality in it, so I would like to start from this type of references to create an interaction that in the context of resilience. There's two spaces I would like to work with. One is Children's Hospital, and the other one is the restaurant. So for the Children's Hospital, I am interested in creating an interactive installation, which is not very invasive to the space, but something that can create a joy, bring joy to the space. And for the restaurant, I'm interested in creating a series of objects or interactions as a course menu that can explore the sensorial experience. Lastly, this is my ongoing archive, which is named as Fridge Gallery. This is like collecting all the images or videos in my daily life that I feel related to the food. For example, the first example shows when I'm making a drip coffee, I felt my behavior and the material is very similar to when I'm watering the plant. Another example is when my aunt tried to cut watermelon to store it, I found the visual is very similar to the puzzles, so I'm just collecting all this together and saving it, but I don't know where this is going, to be honest. But I named it as Fridge Gallery because when I was working with food ingredients, I was storing all my stuff in my fridge, and I thought fridge is also a white cube and has a really nice lighting, so why it can't be a gallery space. But this is all of my presentation. Thank you so much for listening. Not really. They were sometimes there would be like hesitance. There was a couple who came together, and I asked the one person, when was your first kiss? And there was like a little silence. but then eventually they give you the answers. I personally have a lot of questions to my work, because after pandemic, all the things felt very, I'm seeing it in a different context. For example, the first work, the title is Wash Your Hands. Back then it was just like indicating or instruction, but now it feels like it has a total different meaning to it. Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, something that I noticed in my recent project are that I'm not making a project that is instantly reacting. As you can see in my previous works, those interactions are very instant. You will trigger something and the activation will happen. Or my silicon casting process is you pour the silicon, you let it cure, you pop it out, and you repeat the process. But then my recent work or the prototypes, I'm focusing on the process itself or living as it is, or making a slow movement, which I felt was very opposite to what I've been doing. Another thing is, I don't know whether I will remove the tangible or physical elements in my work, because that was very important to me. But still, I'm trying to incorporate and find the right recipe of incorporating art, analog and digital. I guess most of the story or narrative I made so far are based on my experience. I tend to go through more positive ending, but then when I was researching something in Berlin, I was researching Berlin Wall, and in the museum there was showing this children's picture book that was able to pass the censorship because it was considered as a children's picture book, so they didn't really pay much attention to it. So I thought that it's really interesting point to see what this children's picture book as a medium can send information to these young audiences, but that's something I need to really work on still. Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, I think I was coming with the word resilience there was a list of words that I was interested in while I was working with the silicon. There was a tensile strength, friction, tension, and while I was searching, in my process, I often go back and forth to Korean and English to understand the meaning or get the synonym. And in that process, I was getting the word resilience, so I was kind of drawn to it as I was doing this mindfulness meditation, and that was also mentioning about the resilience. So I thought that it has a good resonance with my personal life. Yeah, thank you. Yes. I did it because after prototype I have to just eat all of it, but. The issue with food ingredients was, in my undergrad, students were not allowed to give audience that is edible, so I wasn't able to just really see people interact them as eating process. Right. Yeah. Something that I'm interested in these days is mukbang, which is a live broadcasting eating, which is really popular in Korea. So you will watch people just eat these tons of food in front of you. And I hear people watch these things when they feel lonely to have this kind of companionship through this sensory experience, such as sound, or you see the people eating these tons of food. And I feel it's interesting to see people don't actually eat together in real life, but rather have this screen version of it. But that's something also I'm trying to figure out. Sorry, thank you.
We were having problems with this, so we switched to the next laptop. Yeah, we do not have to. So we might have to use Henrik's laptop. Okay. It's on Google Drive, right? Oh, it's just a PowerPoint?
Yeah.
Do you have it online at all? Or on a phone there?
I don't have it online.
Well, maybe we get lucky. Maybe it'll...
This one?
Yeah, but the problem is that. I think it might work. Funny how sometimes it works. Nothing has changed from earlier. Do you need audio? This computer is already hooked up, so you can just start your PowerPoint. Do you want to open it and just do you have notes as well? Do you have notes? Are these your notes?
Yeah, this one.
Okay. That's your current slide and that's your next slide.
Hello, my name is Hyun Cho. I major in fine art, and after graduating from Korean National University of Art, I used to work at game development company which delivers socio-cultural messages through games. And I also have been making visual works about relationships in recent society, especially in the materialized digital world. I believe that everything in the world is related, and in this unseen relationship, we're constantly impacting each other and changing ourselves. So my practice has been about relationship between humans, humans and technology, as well as artwork and audience. Well, let me introduce my works. For today, I'll pass through these works since we are short of time. In the past, I used various media such as performances, videos, and installation. Recently, I've been using game the most. And among these, I would like to introduce my latest work, City on Edge, first.
So if you want to just, if you want to increase the volume, just press that.
Oh, okay. Thank you. With the topic individual and community, I created City on Edge. City on Edge is a very simple puzzle game where one needs to maintain equilibrium of the ground and community in order to... survive in simulated world threatened by the spread of deadly virus. The game starts when you become a character called Hacker and receive some mission. In the name of taking orders, the player takes control of the people by removing them under his personal judgment. As the level goes higher, the ground gets narrower, and the number of people needed to be needed to achieve the balance of the ground gets smaller. More people need to be sacrificed for the sake of the greater good. And at birth, as a player, it seems like you're not included in that category of people to be sacrificed. However, the player finds out that the main character was also part of the group under control, because the main character must be killed to finish this game. The next game I would like to introduce is Warflower. Warflower is a third-person perspective VR game. The main character of the Warflower is very introverted, so it is very tiring and difficult to create new relationships. And the players of the Warflower find themselves at a party filled with people and can maintain their lives only through conversing with others. In the game, the character has two stats. These two stats are inversely proportional, the energy bar and the presence bar. If the character interacts with people, its physical energy decreases and presence increases. However, if the character continues to avoid interacting with others, its physical energy will recover, but its presence will be reduced and the character will be invisible. So the core rule of this game is to maintain the balance between these two stats and survive till the end. There are four endings in this game, but I will save this for future players. And Wildflower is obviously about my own experience, but I also wanted to talk about the way we understand our existence and relationship in virtual world. In reality, we perceive the world and identify ourselves through our five senses. However, in virtual world, this kind of physical contact is not possible. Then how can we verify our simulated selves inside this virtual world? The players of the Wildflower can maintain their physical form only through socially interacting with others. The next game I would like to introduce is Game Over and Over. Fundamentally, games can operate only to the extent of initial programming made by the programmer. Then, is it possible for a game to evolve on their own, or would it ever be possible for a game to develop itself within its algorithm with few lines of code? That is impossible. If so, what about leaving it for players' evolutionary growth? With this question, I created Game Over and Over. While playing this game, players feel as if the game is alive. And it looks like an ordinary side-scroll game from on the outside, but the character will only follow the commands of the player. If they decide, someone can ensure their survival. They will secretly judge the accuracy of timing when the keys are pressed for dodging obstacles, and choose whether to follow the commands of the player or commit suicide to find the next player. So I wanted this game to seem like a life form with free will. With Game Over and Over, I wanted to do on experiments on relationship between the artwork, audience, and the creator. For now, I'm planning to create another local multiplayer game about an unseen pressure on individuals who are opposing a community's opinion. And my recent interests are digital platform and gig economy. I want to do more research on these topics. And in the future, I want to continue creating interactive art in the form of games and learn more varied art forms such as 3D printing or projection mapping to improve my skills of displaying my work physically. Thank you for listening. Some of the games were made with teams, so sometimes I listen to their opinions. some of the games are inspired by the retro games, 8-bit games. I think each game's visual depends on the subject of the game.
Yes? Do you prefer to operate as a solo game maker?
I think there's different positive points on. I prefer solo, but if I make bigger game, I think it's better to do with teammates. About Wallflower, what I found interesting was some people some people keeps on interacting with characters over and over and becoming invisible. They think becoming invisible as a failure, but what I wanted to say with this game wasn't that about that. So it was very interesting to watch people play. I think there's no more questions. I want to use 3D printing for making game controllers. I usually use keyboard and mouse to present my games, but I think it would be more interesting to use different kinds of controller or mechanisms to play games. Thank you.
That was the last presentation. Thank you, everyone. You all did a great job. I think the grads have a gathering at 6. I don't know where that is, the EDA? Outside the EDA?